And thank you to the organizers for inviting me to participate to this conference. Even more than a conference, I would say an event. We will talk about mainly two topics. One is CO2 warming, but we will see it is actually tiny, and imbalance, the benefit of CO2, which is crop yields and earth greening. The talk is based upon two papers that have been, this one has been published last year, and discusses the anthropogenic warming related to CO2 emissions, but also the natural climate change, in particular, the 60-year cycle. Another paper has been published in the International Journal of Modern Physics. These two publications are included in a long list that reaches, say, 2,500 skeptic papers published in peer-reviewed literature. They have been listed by populartechnology.net and nutrixzone.com. What I define as skeptic papers, that means magnitude of anthropogenic warming is toned down, it's tiny, and natural climate variability is more efficient than anthropogenic CO2 warming. And this is to be compared if you go on the web of knowledge and cross the keywords anthropogenic, greenhouse or CO2, and warming, AGW, you get roughly the same number. But within the two last years, the number of skeptic papers reaches 900 compared to only 363 AGW. Is it a change of paradigm? Let me introduce you the CO2 molecule. The lady at the center is carbon. The two young men are oxygen. That's funny because, you know, they talk about decarbonize. But since there are two oxygen and only one carbon, it should be deoxygenize, isn't it? So we will address the drop of climate sensitivity, which is defined as the Earth warming in case of CO2 doubling in latest published scientific literature. I make my job of expert reviewer as a criticism of the IPCC AR5 last report, discuss natural variability, and insist on the benefit of CO2. Concentration of gas in the atmosphere. You see, this is a question that I address, for example, in front of students in conferences. When I ask the concentration of CO2 in the atmosphere, this was on YouTube, you may check. The answer was between 20% and 80%, and actually it's 0.04%. Water vapor, for example, is much more concentrated, depending on the humidity of the day, but it's much more concentrated, of course, than CO2. But CO2 has increased from 0.03% to 0.04% in one century, and you see this seasonal oscillation that we will discuss later on. First, let's say, just for a moment, that we believe in IPCC. Just for a moment. In IPCC report, it's written that the transient climate response is likely in the range of 1 degree to 2.5 degree, and they have high confidence. Okay, let's apply those numbers to the European climate package, which attempt to reduce by 20% CO2 emissions. It started in 2009, and normally they attempt to reduce CO2 emissions by 20% in 2020. Okay? Europa is responsible for 11% of emissions. Of course, the reduction applies only to the anthropogenic part. Let's assume for the moment that all the increase is purely anthropogenic. This is questionable because when Earth is warming, CO2 which is in the oceans, there are 60 more CO2 in the oceans compared to the atmosphere, and therefore some CO2 from the ocean may be released in the atmosphere. But okay, let's assume for the moment that all this increase is anthropogenic. You see, it's about 25% compared to 75%, so I take care of the ratio. And we have just to multiply, but what says IPCC, the climate sensitivity. The result is below 0.01 degrees Celsius of warming avoided. A panelist this afternoon told us huge cost for nothing. This, I think that's a good example. Now this is the temperature projection in the AR5 report of IPCC. You see the prediction for 2100 is between 0.3 degrees, and then I would agree, and 4.8 degrees. I think, again, this is a good definition of a consensus. Is it 0.3 or a difference of 4.5 degrees? This is larger, this difference, larger than the target of COP something of 2 degrees. And if this is what is written in the summary for policy makers, but inside the report there is a very interesting feature that shows that what is most likely are the low values of the models. This is a figure inside the AR5 report. Why? Of course, because the measurements show practically no increase since the beginning of this century. So they even themselves doesn't believe in their models. Models, how do they work? Well, actually there are two main parameters. One is for cooling and one is for warming. For cooling, they consider aerosols, and that is true, because when there is a big volcanic eruption, the aerosols send in the atmosphere, mask a little bit the radiation from the sun, and the Earth is cooling. We have many examples of that. The largest one was Tambora at the beginning of the 19th century, Tambora, and we have another one, Pinatubo, the most recent one. In that case, temperature has cooled by 0.5 degrees. So, definitely, aerosols are able to cool the Earth. Of course, to warm the Earth, we have the climate sensitivity. What is the increase of temperature for CO2 doubling? In a paper published in 1971, published by Stephen Schneider, a prominent climatologist at that time, climate sensitivity in the paper was 0.8 degrees. Remember that, 0.8 degrees. And the reason for that, they explain, the runaway greenhouse effect doesn't occur because the 50 microns CO2 band, which is the main source of absorption, as we will see later on, saturates, and the addition of more CO2 doesn't substantially increase the infrared opacity of the atmosphere, at this selected frequency, of course. Unfortunately, so they predicted even more cooling at that time in the paper. But the situation has reversed, and then Earth warmed afterwards. And therefore, the climate sensitivity has been increased in the Scharner report and in all the IPCC report up to 3 degrees with an uncertainty between 1.5 and 4.5. Conclusion, climate sensitivity follow temperature, doesn't predict. Are those models validated by observations? Not during the last century, since you see between 1910 and 1945, Earth was warming at the same rate than between 1975 up to the end of the century. But models doesn't see the first warming of same magnitude as the second warming. And of course, model doesn't work at all since the beginning of this century. Here it is detailed. Again, this is probably what they call a consensus between the lowest, because even with the same scenario, for example, the blue curves, there is this spread of projections, which is probably an alternative way to define a consensus. Another picture, again, taken from the AR5 report. You have to look at the horizontal line of the figure, their temperature. The red peak corresponds to the measurements, and the gray distribution are the predictions of model. Of course, it doesn't work at all. Models run 2 to 10 times too hot. So this climate alarmism of the models is not validated by the observation. And this is, again, the figure inside the AR5 report. It's completely contradicted by the summary for policymakers. The summary by policymakers? Maybe. What is the increase of CO2 in the atmosphere? It has increased during the last century, but you see that since the beginning of this century, it seems to saturate to the level of 2 ppm parts per million per year. Since we have 400 ppm nowadays, that means 0.5% of increase per year. Till 2100, if it continues like that, since it seems to saturate, that will be an additional 166 ppm in 2100. The CO2 molecule absorbs selectivity, the radiation of the Earth, the thermal radiation of the Earth, selectivity at 2 selected frequencies or wavelengths. We are, you see the rainbow is the visible part of the spectrum, and you continue beyond the red, you have the infrared part, and you see that the spectroscopy of the atmosphere shows many absorption lines everywhere. Most of them, nearly all of them, are water vapor, which is definitely the most important greenhouse gases if we adopt this definition. The two absorption in red correspond to two motions inside the molecule. Either the young girl kiss alternatively each young man, that's vibration in the middle part of the figure, or she hesitates, and she hesitates and shakes the head like that. This is the vibration of 15 microns, which is the most important. So it's from this situation, if again we reread the paper by Stephen Schneider in 19, published in Science in 1971, it saturates. And we will see that more and more papers published in peer-reviewed literature, there is a number listed here, Herman Arde, Kessin, Abbott and Marwazi, Olila, with different methods, all very recent. They report the climate sensitivity of 0.6 degrees, which is near 0.8 in the paper by Razul and Schneider. If we use that number and consider an increase of CO2 of 2 ppm per year, then you start from the Stefan Boltzmann equation that says that the flux will be related from the temperature of the Earth. Also, you receive the same flux. Differentiating, you get an equation very simple that connects delta T, the increase of temperature, with the increase of radiative forcing. You replace the number, and you find plus 0.2 degrees Celsius in 2100. Is it scary? We can check this calculation by looking at the temperature, not in the low troposphere, but in the low stratosphere, about 17 kilometers of altitude. You see, since 1993, the temperature is almost flat. Nothing has happened, in spite of the fact that during this period, this is 40% of the emissions since the beginning of the industrial era that have occurred, and no change of temperature. At this altitude, we do not see the El Niño phenomena or La Niña phenomena and fluctuation like that. That's clear. The only thing which is seen, and you'll see in the insert of the figure, are just the manifestation of volcanic eruptions. That's all. So there is no impact, no change. And this is not what says IPCC, since in the glossary of the report, one can read, the net amount emitted to space is normally less than would have been emitted in the absence of these absorbers, CO2, because of the decline of temperature with altitude. But here is a spectrum in the around 15 microns, that band where the young girl just shaked her hand, below 11 kilometers and above 11 kilometers. You see in both cases, the CO2 absorption is 100%. 100%, it works very well. It absorbs everything. But above 11 kilometers, profile temperature is changing. There is no decline of temperature up to 11 kilometers and above. Temperature is re-increasing with altitude. And therefore, since the absorption is still 100%, that means emission is not decreased, and therefore, because there is no more decrease of temperature, and therefore there is no weakening of emission, contrary to the statements of the theories on which are based climate models. I mean, those climate models that are written in IPCC report. For all those reasons, people more and more published climate sensitivity that are decreasing versus the year of publication. And this is huge decline because just a linear regression for the two definitions of the climate sensitivity. One is transient climate response. The second one, that means at the moment where there is doubling of CO2, and there is the equilibrium climate sensitivity, which is when the Earth, after several centuries, becomes a rich equilibrium. But in both cases, linear regression shows there is a decline by 10% per year of the published values. Is it the alternative definition of consensus? If we look now in the low troposphere, well, all the institutes that publish temperature data are here. Of course, there are fluctuations, but it is essentially flat, not much difference. And this is just a zoom on the right side of the curve. But if we add all the measurements we have before the satellite era that started in 1979, now we can compare with CO2 emissions. Do you see a correlation? Personally, I do not. Why? Because there was a first increase of temperature by 0.6 degrees at a time where emissions were low. And then, after 1945, emissions increased rapidly, acceleration of emissions. But temperature decreased at that time. Ah. And then, again, it increases again, but this is by no means obvious to see a correlation between both. It's much better to fit with a 60-year cycle, plus a straight line, 0.006 degrees per year. One possibility for this straight line, it might be the tangent to another longer cycle. Maybe Professor Lüdecke will talk about it tomorrow. And that might be the difference. But you see, if this is by no means related to, not obviously at least, related to CO2 emissions, since a straight line doesn't fit the increase of CO2. There are other sentinels of the climate, temperature, of course, sea level rise. This is a figure 314 of IPCC R5, the data. I just asked my computer to find if there is a cycle best fit to this data. It just found the 60-year cycle. And also for the global sea level, but now it's a little bit difficult to conclude because we have just half a cycle since the beginning of the satellite era. So I will use here the Arctic sea ice extent, and you check that when there were a minimum of temperature, you have a maximum of Arctic sea ice, and a maximum of temperature, a minimum of Arctic sea ice. So this 60-year cycle is reported in many papers. One is considered it is related to the Atlantic multidecadal oscillation. In the work of Scafetta, he discussed the possibility of planetary tides of the sun, like the tides on the Earth are related to the moon. But the big planet of the solar system might also provoke tides of the sun, which is just a big ball of gas. Of course, you know in the media this confusion between barometer and thermometer. for lack of observational evidence of significant warming, the global warming wording has been replaced by climate disruption related to extreme meteorological phenomena brandished as an emotional claim proof of the effect. We had example during the last hurricanes. But there is no correlation since during the increase of 40% of CO2 emission, actually there is a decline, slight decline, of accumulated cyclone energy. And there have been a beautiful demonstration of that by the American meteorologists. And they have started from the same model with exactly the same amount of CO2 during a period of 45 years. And the climate model, the same one, by changing by very, very little quantity the initial conditions, the model predicts completely different situation after 45 years. It is intrinsically chaotic, and this has been published into Physical Review long time ago by Edward Lorenz. So CO2 has nothing to do in this story. This is only the intrinsic chaos of climate. Well, after that, remember that CO2 is a gas of life, thanks to photosynthesis, simple for all vegetation on the planet, which receive energy from the sun, heat carbon dioxide and water from the soil, release oxygen, and this is the life of plants. Without CO2, there will be no life vegetation on Earth. In a true greenhouse, this is, has been checked by here by Craig Ixo, changing the concentration of CO2 and studying the growth of plants. It has been done for many, many plants. This is just an example. The increased CO2 concentration have improved crop yields, and by Craig Ixo again, the benefit has been considered to be about 3,000 billion euros since 1971, especially for most important crops. Now I come back just a minute about the seasonal oscillation of CO2. It increases, but here I will consider the amplitude of the seasonal oscillation. You know that in the bottom, there's a value for Antarctica. There is practically no amplitude of the seasonal oscillation. There is no vegetation around. At Mount Naloa, where it is measured now for 1961, you see there is a slight increase of the amplitude of this seasonal oscillation. But at La Jolla in California, the increase is larger. Mauna Loa, I detail it, is just in the center of the Pacific Ocean. La Jolla, of course, is in California. And if we look at the change of amplitude of this oscillation, between 1969 and 2013 at La Jolla, the increase has been by 36%. While in the same time, the increase of CO2 has been only by 21%. So the ratio of both is 71%. That means vegetation was starving. This increase of CO2 is a benefit for all vegetation on Earth. And there had been a publication in Nature Climate Change in last year showing that this is the equivalent of a sixth green continent of 18 million of square kilometers. 18 million of square kilometers. This is four times the area of Europa before Brexit, maybe. So there is also in the media this confusion between CO2, therefore gas of life on Earth, and pollutants. By pollutants, for example, emitted by burning of biomass. There has been a study published by the World Health Organization showing that this is responsible for the fact to breath smoke, aqualine, polycyclic aromatic hydrocarbons, all what is in the smoke of biomass. It is responsible for premature deaths of 4.3 million of people, poor people, per year, especially children and women. This is the third, according to the classification of World Health Organization, this is the third cause of diseases in the world, behind heart diseases and cerebrovascular diseases. Third. Will this problem of dirty cooking be suppressed with more expensive intermittent energy? It has been addressed by several today. The cost, of course, of residential kilowatt hour is increased with installed wind plus solar per inhabitant. So the good news is, Earth is growing greener. And the 0.01% increase of CO2 has helped boost green foliage, plankton, nutritive plants, and crop yields. Climate does change, in particular with alternative periods of warming and cooling every 30 years. The anthropogenic contribution appears tiny, well below dangerous levels. Well, it doesn't mean that we have not to... it would be wise, I say, to consume fossil fuels moderately, to let an heritage to our great children other than an abyssal debt. This is the same in nearly all countries. So, it is important to recognize that the benefit of carbon has to be recognized in balance with a tiny warming. Thank you for your attention.